Welcome back to my channel. So today we are going to study respiration and circulation. So let's begin. First, let's see what is respiration. So respiration is a biochemical process of oxidation of organic compound. That means glucose plus oxygen, that means oxidation, in an orderly manner for liberation of chemical energy in the form of ATP. So your ATP is released, that means energy is released. Now let's see how gaseous exchange takes place in plant. So in plant it takes place by diffusion. Diffusion is nothing but transfer of particles from higher concentration to lower concentration. So oxygen level is high in atmosphere and hence it gets transferred from atmosphere into the plant, that is through leaves and through woods. Through leaves it takes place through stomata. So these are the tiny poles which are known as stomata, and they are guarded by guard cells which helps in opening and closing of the spore. And in wood it takes place through lenticels, as you can see over here. Let's see how human respiratory system is made. So it is made up of upper and lower respiratory tracts. So upper respiratory tract contain nasal cavity, nostrils, pharynx, as you can see over here, and then last is larynx. This forms the upper respiratory tract. Lower respiratory tract is made up of trachea. Trachea divides and forms bronchus. Then they divide and form bronchioles, which ends in alveoli. Lungs, these are the lungs, and this is the diaphragm. This forms the lower respiratory tract. So let's see first about the nose. So nose, there is nostril. There are two nostrils which are the opening of the nasal cavity and lie above the mouth. They are separated by a septum which is known as mesothmoid cartilage, as you can see over here. This is the cartilage which separates left and right nose. After nostril, there is nasal chamber, in which they are lie about the palate. So this is the palate and this is the nasal chamber. They are divided into three regions. First is vestibular region, followed by respiratory region, and then upperly it comes olfactory region. So vestibular region contains hair, which helps in preventing dust particles to enter into the respiratory system. Then this is the respiratory region, where which is lined by respiratory epithelium, and the last one, which is olfactory, which is lined by olfactory epithelium, which acts as an organ of smell. After nasal cavity, what comes is known as pharynx. Pharynx is divided into three parts: nasopharynx, oropharynx, and laryngopharynx. They also contain lymphoid tissue, which are known as tonsils. Also, this pharynx now divides into two. First is larynx, which forms the respiratory system, further respiratory system, and the other part forms is in esophagus, which forms the food tube. Moving on further, which is larynx, which is also known as Adam's apple, and it is more prominent in men than women. It is also known as sound box because it helps in producing sound, as it contains vocal cords. Now this laryngopharynx open into a larynx through an opening which is known as glottis. It is also guarded by a leaf-like cartilaginous structure which is known as epiglottis, so that the food can easily pass in esophagus. So when there is a swallowing, this epiglottis closes the larynx, so the respiratory system is closed and the food can enter into esophagus. Now the larynx is in continuation with trachea. Trachea is 10 to 12 cm in length. It runs through the neck in the front of the esophagus, and it has C-shaped cartilage 16 to 20, which helps which prevents collapsing of the trachea. It is lined by ciliated pseudostratified epithelium and contains mucus gland, which helps in trapping the particles or dust particles which enters into the lungs, which prevents through entering into the lungs. Now this trachea is divided further into two, which is known as bronchus. Primary bronchus, which further divides and forms secondary bronchus. Then it forms tertiary bronchus, Then this tertiary bronchus divides and form bronchioles, which finally divides into terminal bronchiole and which ends into a sac-like structure which is known as alveoli. This whole thing is known as bronchial tree. Lungs, which is the most important organ of respiratory system, is protected by a double layer of pleural membrane. As you can see, this is lungs and this is protected by a pleural membrane. This pleural membrane are formed of two parts. First is outer one, which is known as parietal pleural, and the inner one, which is known as visceral pleural. In between this pleural membrane, there is a fluid which is known as pleural fluid. Now the lobes. Talking about the lobes, so right lobe, right lung is divided into three lobes and the left lung is divided into two lobes. Now, what are alveoli? They are the end point of the respiratory system and it helps in exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the bloodstreams. Okay, and they are grape-like structures. Now, what is diaphragm? So, diaphragm is the muscular septum which separates thoracic cavity and abdominal cavity. It is the primary muscle of respiration. The shape is dome shape, but when it contracts, it becomes flat. Moving on to the second part, which is known as external respiration. So in this, what happens is diffusion of gas. So the gas diffuses from higher partial pressure to the lower partial pressure. So for example, let's see, in alveoli, the oxygen partial pressure is 100 and in blood, the partial pressure of oxygen is 40. So the oxygen diffuses from alveoli to capillaries and the carbon dioxide's partial pressure in capillary is 45 and that in the alveoli is 40. So diffusion of carbon dioxide takes place from capillaries to alveoli. The third part, which is internal respiration, so this means exchange of gases between the RBCs, that means hemoglobin. So the first is transport of oxygen. So the degree of saturation of hemoglobin with O2, that is oxygen, depends upon the oxygen tension. Now what is meant by saturation of hemoglobin is how much oxygen the blood can carry. So if oxygen level is high, so saturation will be also high, but simultaneously hemoglobin concentration should be also high for to increase the saturation of hemoglobin or to increase the supply of oxygen in blood. So there are some conditions. 100% saturation is rare. So maximum saturation of 90 to 95 97% of is at partial pressure in alveoli. That means that 95 to 97% of oxygen can be carried by the blood, that is hemoglobin. Degree of saturation decreases with a drop in oxygen. So of course, if the oxygen level decreases, saturation of oxygen in blood will also decrease. At 30 mmHg of partial pressure of oxygen, only 50% saturation can be occurred. Like if there is 30 mm of oxygen in blood, 50% of saturation can be attained. Now this is explained through a graph in which on y-axis there is saturation of hemoglobin and on x-axis there is partial pressure of oxygen. So as the partial pressure of oxygen increases, saturation is also increased. If The partial pressure decreases, the saturation also decreases, and the graft is shifted towards the right side. So right shift due to increase in carbon dioxide. So there is increase in carbon dioxide and decrease in oxygen level. Temperature is also increased, acidity of the blood is also increased. So there is shift in right side. This means there is deoxygenated blood. Moving on to the second part of the internal respiration, that is transport of carbon dioxide. So this carbon dioxide in the plasma diffuses into the RBC, combines with the water and form carbonic acid in presence of carbonic hydrogenase anhydrase. Since carbonic anhydrase is present only in RBC. Now this is unstable and hence it gets dissociate into H plus ions and bicarbonate. This bicarbonate through diffusion passes into the plasma. Now something negative is going outside the red RBC, so something has to come inside to maintain the balance. So this Na plus and Cl minus, they get dissociate. NaCl gets dissociate and the Cl minus ion gets inside the RBC. Now this is called as chloride shift. And this H plus ion which is formed combines with the hemoglobin and it makes the blood more acidic. Now this is transport of carbon dioxide. Last step, which is cellular respiration, which is the last step taking inside the cell where the food is oxidized and ATP is generated. There are two steps: oxidation, in which the glucose get oxidized to form carbon dioxide and water, and second is phosphorylation, that is release of ATP. Moving on further, the next half part of the chapter, which is circulation. Circulation in humans or animals are carried out by special fluid called blood and lymph. So there are two types of circulation. First one is closed circulatory system and second one is open circulatory system. In closed circulatory system, blood flows through the blood vessels, and in closed open circulatory system, the blood flows through an open space called sinuses. Blood pressure is more over here and blood pressure is less. Speed of the blood is more and speed of the blood is less. Hemoglobin like pigment are present in closed blood circulation, which are necessary for gaseous exchange. No such pigment like hemoglobin is needed. As such, there is no gaseous exchange which takes place. Closed circulation are of further two types. One is single circulation, in which the blood passes through the heart only once during the cycle, and double circulation, in which the blood passes through the heart two times. Now let us see how blood is formed. So blood is formed of two parts. One is plasma and one is formed elements or cellular elements. Plasma contains amino acids, nutrients, proteins. Proteins mainly albumin, fibrinogen and globulins. And it also contains nitrogenous waste, electrolytes and gas. Now formed elements are formed of three parts. First is erythrocytes, which are also known as RBC. Second is platelets, and third is leukocytes, which are also known as WBCs. Now these WBCs are of two types, granulocytes and agranulocytes. Granulocytes are of three types, neutrophils, basophils and eosinophils. And agranulocytes are of two types, lymphocytes and monocytes. Now let's see what are RBCs or erythrocytes. So these are biconcave disc shaped structure, as you can see over here. In male, the counts are 5.4 million per cubic mm of blood, and in females the range is from 4.8 million per cubic of the blood. They have no nuclei, functional for about 120 days. Production occurs in the red bone marrow. This process is known as erythropoiesis and controlled by a protein which is known as erythropoietin. Contains hemoglobin. What are the function of RBCs? Transport of oxygen from lungs to the tissue and carbon dioxide from the tissue to the lungs. So this is the main function of RBC. White blood cells, which are also known as leukocytes, the range is from 5000 to 10000 per cubic mm of blood. produced by leucophoresis in the red bone marrow and it contains nuclei. What are the functions? So the functions are defense against pathogens. For example, if bacteria enters into our body, this white blood cells gets activated and starts to fight against that bacteria. Removal of toxins and waste and damaged cells. Two types, granulocytes which form 75% of total WBC and agranulocytes which form 25% of total WBC. Granulocytes include neutrophils, eosinophils and basophils, and agranulocyte includes lymphocytes and monocytes. Now what is leukocyte and leukopenia? So leukocytosis means an increase in number of WBC above 10,000 is known as leukocytosis, and leukopenia is a decrease in the number of white blood cells below 5,000 is known as leukopenia. Now let's see the first type of granulocyte, that is neutrophil. It contains 60 to 70% of total WBC. Granules are present and hence it is known as granulocyte, but they do not stain with dyes. Diameter is 10 to 12 nanometer. Nucleus is usually 2 to 4 lobes, as you can see over here. The function is phagocytic, that means it can eat the bacteria. So one neutrophil can phagocyte 5 to 20 bacteria. Second type of granulocyte, which is basophil, it forms 2.5 to 1% of total WBC. Granule stains with basic purple blue dye. Diameter is 8 to 10 nanometer. Nucleus are irregular and usually two lobes or it is twisted. Granules contain heparin and histamine. So they are basically present at the site of infection in which they get converted into the mast cell, and also at the allergic reactions. Basophils and mast cell release histamine, bradykinin and serotonin. Moving to the third type of granulocyte, which is eosinophil, it forms 2 to 4% of total WBC. Granulocytes stain by red acidic dyes. So diameter is 10 to 12 nanometer. Nucleus is usually two lobes, as you can see over here. So their function is involved in allergic reaction and parasitic infections. They destroy the antigen-antibody complex and restrict the process of inflammation. That is, they stop the process of further inflammation. Monocyte, which is a type of agranulocyte, that means they do not contain granules. So there are 3 to 8% of total WBC. The diameter is 12 to 20 nanometer. Nucleus is oval or kidney shape, as you can see over here. The monocytes are converted into macrophages of the tissues. The function is phagocytosis, that means to eat up the bacteria. Lymphocytes, they form 20 to 25% of total WBC. Depending upon the site of production and their action, they get divided into T cells, which are also known as cell-mediated immunity, and B cells, which are known as antibody or humoral immunity, and natural killer cells. They are divided into two, small lymphocytes where the diameter is small, that is 6 to 9 nanometer, and large lymphocyte where the diameter is 10 to 40 nanometer. Nucleus is round, as you can see over here, and they play an important role in immunity. Neutrophils form the first line of defense. That means if there is some infection, acute infection, neutrophils come first. Once neutrophils fail to fight against the infection, monocyte come into the picture and do the process of phagocytosis. So moving on to the further part, which is known as platelets or lymphocytes. So the size is 4 nanometer in diameter, shape is disc shape, the mean count is 1,30,000 to 4 lakhs per mm cubic of blood. Morphology, they are non-nucleated fragments of cell. The site of production is bone marrow. They are produced from megakaryocyte cells. This is very important. Lifespan is 5 to 9 days and the main function is blood coagulation or blood clotting. Now, let's see how blood coagulation takes place. So, if there is an injured tissue, that means if there is a cut in the tissue, it leads to bleeding. So, the platelets get activated. So, this releases prothromboplastin. Prothromboplastin in presence of calcium gets converted into thromboplastin. Now this thromboplastin acts as a catalyst and converts prothrombin into thrombin. And now this thrombin acts as a catalyst and converts fibrinogen into fibrin, which forms fibrin polymerase, which leads to clot formation. So as you can see over here, it gets sealed, fibrin get accumulated, and it forms a sealing which stops the bleeding. Now moving on to the circulatory system. So as we all know, heart is an organ at the center of the circulatory system. It pumps the blood all throughout the body. So there are two parts. First part, right side and left side. Right side contain oxygen poor blood, that means deoxygenated blood, and left side contain oxygen rich blood. Now the heart is enclosed into a membranous sac, so which is known as pericardium. Pericardium are of two parts, fibrous pericardium and serous pericardium. Now the serous pericardium are again divided into two parts, that is parietal pericardium, that is the outer covering, and the inner covering, which is known as visceral pericardium. In between these two pericardium, there is pericardial fluid. Inside the pericardium, there are heart walls. So there are three parts of heart wall. First is epicardium, the outermost layer, as you can see over here. Second layer is myocardium. Myo means muscle, so muscle layer. And third is endocardium, the innermost layer. Now let's see external surface of heart. So the heart is formed of four chambers: right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium and left ventricle. Right atrium and right ventricle are separated through a coronary sulcus, which is also known as atrioventricular groove. Right ventricle and left ventricle are separated through interventricular sulcus, as you can see over here. Pulmonary trunk arises from the right ventricle, and which carries the deoxygenated blood to the lungs, and left ventricle to rise to aorta. So the oxygenated blood is pumped to the body. So the left ventricle, aortic valves give three branches, that is brachiocephalic artery, left common carotid artery, and left subclavian artery. This aorta and pulmonary trunk are joined together through a ligament which is known as ligamentous arteriosus. Right ventricle receives blood from superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, and left atrium receives blood from the pulmonary veins, which contains oxygenated blood from the lungs. Now let's see the internal structure of heart. So it is, first let's see atria. So atria are thin walled receiving chamber. So right atria receives blood from whole body, and left atria receives blood from lungs through pulmonary vein. Two atria separated by an interauricular septum, as you can see over here. This is the septum. It interauricular septum contains an oval depression which is called as fossa ovalis. This is fossa ovalis, as you can see over here, which is a remnant of embryonic aperture called as foramen ovalis. So during the birth time or during the intrauterine life, the right atria and left atrium are in connection through foramen ovale. But as the birth takes place, this ovale gets covered and form fossa ovalis. Now the right atria receives three openings: superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and sulcus sinus. Inferior vena cava is guarded by a valve which is called as Eustachian tube, and coronary sinus is guarded by a valve called as Thebaceous valve. Now let's see the internal structure of ventricles. So right atrium opens into right ventricle through a valve which is known as tricuspid valve. Left atrium opens into left ventricle through a valve which is known as mitral or bicuspid valve. These valves are attached to a muscle which are known as caudate tendineae, which in turn are attached to the papillary muscles. This whole mechanism or this whole structure helps in opening and closing of the valves. This papillary muscle in turns are attached to trabeculae carnei, which are present on the walls of the ventricles. Right atrium gives opening to pulmonary artery, which carries deoxygenated blood to the lungs. Left ventricle gives rise to aorta, which carries oxygenated blood and it is pumped throughout the body. This pulmonary artery and pulmonary veins are guarded by valves which are known as semilunar valves. Now let's see the pumping action of heart. So diastole and systole are the two concepts. So what is diastole? So when the heart relaxes, that means when the heart receives the blood, it is known as diastole. And systole, which means when the heart contracts or pumps the blood outside or through outside the heart, or it pumps to the body, it is known as systole. So what is heart rate? So number of heart beats per minute. So the time the heart contracts and contracts and pumps the blood throughout the body is known as systole. That means heart beat. So heart rate is expressed as heart beats per minute. So basically it is 72 minutes beats per minute. Now let's see the conducting tissues of the heart. So heart is myogenic organ. That means heart is capable of generating a cardiac contraction independent of nervous input. That means heart does not require any impulse or any signals from the brain. It can generate its own contraction. So whenever the blood receives in the right atrium, SA node get activated, which is present in the right atrium. The impulse are passed through AV node. AV node then passes the impulse to bundle of His, which is present in the interatrial septum. Now this gets divided into left bundle branch and right bundle branch, which further carries the impulse to the Purkinje fibers in the myometrium, which is the muscle layer of, that is the wall of the heart. Now this impulse causes contraction, which leads to pumping of blood, and the blood is pumped throughout the body. So this is the conducting tissue of the heart, that is SN node, AV node, bundle of His, which divides into left bundle, right bundle, and then finally reaches Purkinje network of Purkinje fibers, which are present in the myometrium, and contraction takes place. Now let's see the phase of cardiac cycle. First, understand the difference between the systole and diastole. Systole means contraction, that means it will pump the blood from that area, and diastole means relaxation, which means it will receive the blood. So when the right atrium receives deoxygenated blood and left atrium receives oxygenated blood, this produces pressure on the walls of the atria, which stimulates SN node to generate the signals, and the cardiac impulse are produced, and this will cause systole, that means it will pump the blood into the ventricles, the respective ventricles. Now further, what happens is when this blood are received into the ventricles, this the SN node gets stimulated, and then this will pass the signal to the bundle of His to Purkinje fibers, and this will lead to contraction of the ventricles. So the deoxygenated blood will be pumped from the pulmonary trunk towards the lung, and oxygenated blood will be pumped towards the aorta through towards the whole body. So this will lead to ventricular systole. And after the blood is pumped out, there will be ventricular diastole, which means it will receive the blood again from the atria. During the receival, the semilunar valves are closed. So this leads to a cardiac cycle. Now if we see on ECG graph, what we will see is P wave, which is atrial depolarization, which means atrial systole. Then followed by a QRS complex, which means ventricular depolarization, which means ventricular systole, followed by a T wave, which is ventricular repolarization, which means ventricular diastole. Now let's see about blood vessels. So there are three blood vessels: artery, veins, and capillaries. So they are formed of three, they have three coverings: ट्यूनिका एडवेंटिशिया, ट्यूनिका मीडिया एंड ट्यूनिका इंटिमा. नाउ ट्यूनिका मीडिया इज वेरी थिन इन वेन्स, ल्यूमेन इज नैरो इन आर्टरी एंड इन ल्यूमेन इज बिगर इन वेन्स. आर्टरी कैरी मोस्टली ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड एक्सेप्ट पल्मोनरी आर्टरी विच कैरी डी ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड एंड पल्मोनरी वेन कैरीज डी ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड एक्सेप्ट पल्मोनरी वेन विच कैरी ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड. आर्टरी ऑलवेज टेक ब्लड अवे फ्रॉम द हार्ट एंड वेन ऑलवेज सप्लाई द ब्लड टू द हार्ट. Okay, and then comes the capillaries, which are lined by the thin layer of endothelial cells, and these are the nucleus of the endothelial cells. So they form a network. So arteries divides into arterioles. They form small capillaries, which rejoins and form venules, and which forms veins, and which return back to the heart. Last one is blood pressure. So it is defined as the force exerted by the blood against the blood vessel. The highest pressure in the cycle is the systolic blood pressure and the lowest is the diastolic. It is measured in mm of mercury. It is measured through a device which is known as syngogalvanomanometer, and mostly brachial artery is being used, which is present in the upper arm. So the normal value is 120 by 80. So where the systole is 120 and diastole is 70. Thank you. Hope you like this video. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe, and share your views in the comment section below. Till then, bye.